Whoa. Okay, okay. Now, finally, you can start the show. Well, my half, anyway. And, yeah, like I said, everyone's been asking me, how was CEO? And, again, I kind of thought, you know what? I'm going to do a damn show because, well, somebody asked for it. Because, quite frankly, typing it over Twitter, Skype, kind of does it no justice. So, basically, the too long, didn't read bit is, the event was so bloody good that I've got withdrawal symptoms. I'm not gonna lie. I'm literally thinking. Whoa! What the hell was that?
That was a message tone. It's Yoshi from Super Mario Land 2.
Oh god.
Ignore that.
Where was I? No, literally, CEO was so damn good. I'm not gonna lie. I'm getting withdrawal symptoms. I'm actually literally thinking, damn. This time last week, I was in Florida, or literally every other week, and that's how damn good it is. And so if you're watching the vlogs right now, no doubt, you're just going to skip ahead to when Jebailey comes on. And yeah, I was actually able to get Jebailey. Well, not for this half, because literally as we speak right now, the man is rushing home. He's going to add me on Skype, and then, whoa, apparently I'm mad quiet? Well,
seems fine to me.
Okay, yo guys, is my mic okay?
Yeah, just go on with the show.
Okay, okay.
Yeah, it's okay now, apparently.
Okay.
We're quiet, so.
Okay, yeah. It might be the stupid little threshold thing on Skype, which, probably got to sort that out at some point, because obviously, I'm a loud git, so yeah, I tend to shout a lot. But where was I then? But again, if you're watching the vlog, the VODs right now, you're going to probably skip ahead to when Jebailey does eventually come on, because like I said, as we speak, Jebailey is going to rush home, he's going to jump on Skype, and he's going to join us. And the reason why the show is so damn late is because obviously there's a bloody time difference, because they're like 6 hours in the past. It's about 5 hours, because British summertime, we had that, 1 hour forwards or backwards, but that doesn't matter. But anyway, where did I begin? Well, the first thing is, everyone was asking, why didn't I go to Evo?
Evo is mad expensive, yo.
Well, that too, but I don't know. I'm actually just thinking for a second. That's kind of the trap, don't you reckon, everybody gets into, because it's like, let's face it, hardly anybody ever goes to American tournaments because of the fact it's so damn expensive, and because it's so expensive, you might as well just go to Evo. But it's like, I'm thinking, but then you'd overlook some really cool events, and, you know, CEO just happened to be one of them, so... Yeah, but again, it was primarily because... there was a point I had a choice, because I was originally wanting to go to UFGT, but that didn't happen because I spent a little too much money going to hype spotting. But again, now... But again, I don't regret that, because hype spotting was mad good, and...
Remember when we woke you up when you were sleeping?
I remember that bit. Everyone.
You were nodding off while I think it was like Afro was making an announcement or something, and then Scott shouted out, "Yo guys, everyone be quiet!" And then they were sneaking up to just go and scare you, but you woke up while everyone was creeping up behind you. That was a pretty sick moment, and you got a free game for it, so that's pretty sick. What did you end up getting? Was it Devil May Cry?
Yeah, on the 360, which I don't happen to own, but I will eventually at some point, so yeah, that'd be cool. But the thing is, I actually wanted to get that game anyway, but I didn't want to pay for it, so it's kind of weird that it worked out nicely, because again, I don't want to...
You should fall asleep at like every event and see how it works.
I don't think that's going to work again, but anyway.
But Skirmish, just think, if you had have gone to UFGT, you could have entered the Mystery Game Tournament, and you would have buddied people in this game.
Yeah, damn. Yeah, I was thinking about that.
Battle construction vehicles.
Okay.
Right, let's get those holiday slides up, because and hopefully it'll work this time. Aha! There we go. Yeah, first and foremost, that was the venue. Yeah, not the venue, that was my room, and it was the Wyndham Hotel Resort, and I'm gonna be honest with you, if you actually read reviews for the Wyndham Hotel, they are proper bad. We're talking like proper one star, two star reviews. So I was proper petrified. I'm thinking, oh my god, well, am I gonna get proper bumped? But the hotel.
I was thinking, alright room, to be fair.
No, no, because literally, if you were reading all the reviews on it, and it was actually kind of true, half the hotels, yeah, half the hotel complex was properly demolished. It's like, yeah, if you actually look on Google Photograph, I don't know if it's still there, and it's like, when I went to the event, yeah, about one third of the actual resort was actually demolished. It was actually, you know, we're talking proper Spanish sort of holiday job. So I was thinking, I don't know about, well, actually, I didn't see that part until like the next day, but no, seriously, the hotel was proper clean.
But the thing, yeah, it looks pretty good.
But the other, no, but the other thing I kind of missed out on, yeah, I'll get back to the photographs in a minute, was...
You know, that ring, that is so sick, the way they're getting a ring. I always like it when Yipes is, like, talking on the mic as well. He always brings so much hype. Like, I don't know if you guys watched it as well, but they had a stream on last night, and it was just embarrassing. Like, F-Champ was on the commentating with Yipes.
Oh, that was so funny. Yipes, and Yipes just like, I don't like you. Fucking hilarious.
Put the headphones down and go.
Okay, hold up. Apparently, my sound is still messing up. Yo, guys, is my sound still good? Sound check. Sound check. Yep, is my mic good, guys? 30 seconds wait.
It sounds grand from hearing it back on the stream.
Okay.
Okay, yeah, sounds okay the same. Okay. Yeah, but like, I thought it was so disrespectful the way he called Infrit a washed-up motherfucker. And I was like, in front of like all his friends watching and all the other fighting game players, and just to call him after playing, I mean, it's just a game. It's like, you don't disrespect other fighting game players like that.
And the thing about that is, Infrit actually, you know, he has a life, he has a job and a woman and all that.
Yeah, whereas F-Champ would go in training mode and then record a video and get loads of people to pay for him, to pay for his rent.
Exactly.
That's actually his life.
Okay. You know, if that works for him, then, you know, fair play, but don't shit on a dude who just lives his normal life and plays Marvel for a bit of fun.
Yeah, but it's like, the fact he's shown disrespect towards you, like, Infrit after playing him, I thought that was... Like, I used to think the guy was cool. He puts a lot of work into doing videos, shows punishment videos and stuff like that. And then for him to just, like, say, you know, it's a washed-up motherfucker, don't let me be disrespected by playing against him and all this stuff. I was like, why is he acting like this?
Anyway, guys, getting back to the talk of CEO, I mean, as... funny enough, I didn't speak to F-Champ, although the odd thing was I kind of did walk past... Yeah, that was the weird thing. It's like, because you're used to seeing all these guys on the streams and stuff. But it's like, literally, all of a sudden, I'm walking past them in the halls. So that was the most surreal That's the most surreal thing. And then it's like, my content-producing brain was like, wait, I'm going to grab that guy for an interview. But problem was, I didn't want to come across as a proper fangirl. I don't know. I probably would be a crap journalist, because my problem was, I didn't want to, you know, because literally, the only time I grabbed people for interviews and stuff was literally if they were by themselves or they weren't doing anything, because most of the time, again, the FGC in America, again, we're skipping points. They're not really different from us. They all hang out in big groups. So it's like, you'd see Justin, you see Mike Ross, they're all talking together. There was a case of, I couldn't just, sorry, Mr. Justin, I couldn't grab you for an interview, could I? And again, that would be kind of terrible. Anyway, hold up.
Well, you did manage to grab Brother Keo, thinking that he was Hell Pockets.
Yeah, but in all honesty, though, he did, from all angles, and even the way he sounded, he did sound a lot like Hell Pockets until I did the interview and I realised, okay, he isn't Hell Pockets. Although, actually, true, do you know what the disturbing thing was? There are bare people I walked past a zillion times and I didn't actually realise until who they were until the ring, because, you know, I was, like, filming stuff in the ring. It was like, I had no idea who Rio looked like. Well, actually, I do know what Rio looked like, but it's like he looked a lot different on stream because, you know, most of the time on the streams, he's got his, like, hoodie up. So it's like, there he is in the ring just wearing a little red shirt. And it's like, I didn't realize he was Rio until literally he was right in front of me in the ring. And it was like...
It was godlike, though, because I was watching the Marvel stream. And then I was just watching it. I was just enjoying it. And I saw in the pants of the ring and all of a sudden see Skirmish with a big camera filming everything. And I was like, oh, shit, I got mad.
When I saw him on stream, like, in the ring with Yipes, and Yipes was like, hey, guys, don't touch my pillow. I was like, step to it. That was brilliant. Like, Skirmish was, like, literally a foot away from it. It's so surreal, like, seeing him in the same ring as Yipes and Jebailey and all that. So,
You thought that was surreal. I thought it was surreal and all. It was like, I'll be brutally honest. I did not realize. I didn't think I could get that close. But it was like, Jebailey, he says, no, you're safe. You're media. It was like, really? So, yeah, that was the reason why I was allowed into the ring. Because, again, a lot of people, they got probably cleared out of the ring. And it was like, just in case. And he even reminded me, saying, yeah, tomorrow's the final day. So, you know, get in the ring. Grab all you need. I mean, he did set some rules aside. Like, for a start, don't move around. Basically, don't move around while the players are playing games, because obviously you can distract them.
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
Oh my god! Mr. Jebailey is here! Okay. Okay, man. Add you in a sec. Right. Add to group call. Hold up. I'm going to go to your window first, and then add people to call.
Steel contacts. Your guys, check it out.
Hello?
Oh, coming live from America, we have the People's Tournament Organizer, Mr. Alex... No, sorry. CEO Alex Jebailey. How are you doing, brother?
I'm doing good. Just came home from work, so I jumped on as fast as I could.
I'm really, really grateful, brother, for that. Because again, it is awfully tricky because you're like 5 hours in the past.
I always get off work at 6, never earlier. So, but no worries, I'm here. I have some actually Smash players coming over in a half hour to train me for Evo. As funny as that sounds.
Okay. Well, I can't wait for the hype matches of Smash Brothers. I've seen a few of the videos. It just looks crazy, just jumping around, double jumping, following all the time. I like the ledge thing as well, like when you stay on the ledge and then they can't get back on that way. It's really skank that. I can't wait for it, Evo. It's going to be so sick.
Yeah, I am actually excited for it. I really used to love the game and play, but then I didn't like Brawl when it came out. But I always played Melee, so I'm excited to play it.
Yeah, super good.
I'm just dying to see some wombo combos.
Okay, let me just... give you a nice little place on the overlay, and wow, damn. Okay, because I started a little bit tournament standard time, I didn't get to finish my points about my experiences at CEO. So I guess you can get to hear them, and hopefully we can have enough time for the Q&A and some points. But anyway, as I was actually just telling my colleagues, the American FGC, they're not really that far apart from us. Because again, I was having a really enlightened conversation with Mr. Banana Ken, and you know, because, you know, over here, we have this bizarre myth that the American scenes have got, like, massive pools of players. But, you know, from what he was telling us, most of America is pretty fast-paced apart. And most scenes are, like, they're, like, similar numbers to our scene. They're, like, you know, what, 15, maybe 20 people at best? So there's not, like, pools of, like, hundreds of people.
What was the question? I am so sorry. I zoned out tweeting out your name.
Ah, gotcha. No way, bro. No, I was having... Now, as I was saying, I was having a really enlightened conversation with Banana Ken at CEO, and he was just telling me how some of the American scenes, they're actually really far spaced apart, and that some of their numbers, they're really similar to ours. They're only like really, what, 12, maybe 10 people, or even 20 people. So it's
You're talking about for the smaller games, right?
Well, yeah, like I said, or just certain scenes in general.
Oh, yeah, I mean, America is pretty spaced out. It's not like Japan where everything's centralized. Yeah, I mean, there's online play, obviously. Still, you don't get as much enjoyment playing online as you do at a tournament. But it starts small, man. Back when Street Fighter 4 came out, the first tournament we had in Orlando only had 14 entrants, and I won that one. That's how small it was. And then obviously now we're at CEO this year. It's grown since then. But, I mean, it starts small. Some places aren't as lucky as others to have people nearby or they're too far apart. But America is really spread apart. So there's a lot of big scenes and then there's a lot of small scenes. But as long as you find a good group of 5-6 friends to play with, you can have as much fun as you want.
Mm-hmm. Oh, excellent. Again, as I'm trying to ghetto sort out these layouts I was actually telling my colleagues earlier, yeah, regarding the actual resort, yeah, the actual hotel, the Wyndham. I heard some pretty bad reviews. It was like proper 1 or 2 stars reviews. But when I actually got there, no, the actual hotel itself was fine. The staff were, wow, they were like literally jumping it over themselves, like help, you know, to the help beer. It's like the minute, you know, you're seen like lugging a bag, it'll be like, oh, can I take that for you, sir?
Yeah, I mean, it had bad reviews because the hotel is about 30 years old now, around 30 years, and it was never renovated until this year. They almost actually shut the whole place down, and they told me right before I signed the contract for this year. So as I was finding that out, they were like, we're going to shut down. We are so sorry. So I started looking around for places, and then 2 weeks later, they call me back. Good news, we're not shutting down. We got bought out, but they're only tearing down half the place. So two, 3 years ago, yes, the hotel had its issues, but it's completely new management. They're renovating every room. It's going to be amazing next year. Like, you saw the construction this year, but I'm really excited for next year. They have new ballrooms being built. There's going to be at least 10 new restaurants that are right at the hotel. So it's going to be really good next year.
Oh, yeah, for sure. I'll just finish up my point so we can get straight to yours, because obviously your time's a little limited since wouldn't want to keep you from Smash.
they won't be here for an hour, so take your time.
Oh, okay, that's good. Oh, phew. where do I begin? I mean, I was just trying to explain to my colleagues. You know, the bizarre thing is, I was really laser beam focused on, oh my god, I'm going to go to an American resort. I mean, I'm going to go to an American FGC tournament that I actually just bizarrely overlooked. Dude, I'm going to Florida. Dude, I'm going to Orlando. Dude, Orlando is like theme park central. It only hit me literally during the daytime that I could just catch a bus. I could be at Disney World, and perhaps you could even sort me out with some tickets, I heard. Just saying. And Busch Gardens. And like, yeah, I mean, if I was to, redo it right now, I would probably go an extra day early and actually visit those theme parks, because the most bizarre thing was, every time I told people I'm going to Orlando, and they said, oh, you're going to a theme park? I said, no, I'm going to play fighting games. And they said, what? And I don't know how hard it is for you to explain to people, but it normally takes me about 10 seconds to explain. I play competitive fighting games, Street Fighter, even though I don't play Street Fighter, and yeah.
I mean, it used to be really hard to explain, but now I've kind of gotten it down to a science, so I've never had a problem. But if you come back next year, come a day early, I'll get you into any theme park you want for free. Just let me know.
Damn! Yep,
you just have to ask me. That offer only goes for you because you came all the way from England. what should I call it? What was the question again? I'm so sorry. My mind's still gone.
Jebailey.
Yep.
If I come all the way from Ireland, can I get into theme parks for free?
If you're I can only do one day at one place, so you have to choose wisely. Sorry. But if you do come next year, come with Skirmish, and then you guys... By the way, General, what is your real name? I don't even know.
My real name is classified, but I can tell you my horrible English name, which I used in America. It's Danny.
Okay, that's not so bad.
Yep. Now the rest of the gaming populace knows my horrible English name, which I rarely use because I hate the concept of English names, because it's a case of just because I come from a foreign land, you should kind of learn how to pronounce my name. So I will. Sorry. I digress. But yeah, Danny, be nice.
Okay.
I'll tell you over email what it is.
Okay, no problem. So yeah, what was the other question? I'm so sorry.
No, it wasn't a question. It was just. I was just pointing out how I was just overlooking the fact that I was actually in bloody Florida or Orlando.
Oh, yeah. And it's when people ask me, like, what do you do? What's your convention about? I just say people that love video games and they like to compete for prizes. I mean, that's the easiest way I can explain. And then I just show them, like, a hype video. And then that's about it. I mean, we're a lot more mainstream than we were 5 years ago, where it was like, you play video games? Ew. But now everybody plays games, whether it's on their cell phone or, so it's not as bad to talk about anymore. And I used to be not ashamed of it, but I used to not really talk about games to my normal friends, as so to speak, because I do party a lot and go out. But now everyone knows what I do, and they support it because they see the success I've had with it. So it doesn't matter anymore. Just tell people you're doing something you love to do, and if they don't, if that bothers them, they can bugger off, as you guys would say.
I'm so glad I recorded you saying that, mate. But in all honesty, mate, thanks to your event, I could, yeah, because obviously the minute I mentioned to them, you're going all the way to Florida just to play computer games, I would just literally have to show them that short recap video I've just posted up, and no, this is what I'm going to.
Exactly. It's a good time, man. Seeing everyone happy, smiling. I mean, because of CEO, I've created so many friendships in Florida. I've even helped people get jobs. So it's been a great, that's the reason I do it, is the connections I've created for all these people to just enjoy a hobby. That way, when they come to the tournament, they don't have to be stressed for the weekend. They're just having a good time. Obviously, you have to go back to reality when you're done, but yes, as long as those few moments make them happy and laugh, that's what makes it so special for me.
I was explaining earlier, because for the too long didn't read point of, yeah, because again, literally everyone's been asking me, yo, Skirmish, how was CEO? And it's like, how was CEO? And I keep telling them, you know what, I'm going to do this show on Monday, because quite frankly, writing it over Twitter, Skype, kind of does it no justice. And the fact that you are here, just, again, that, again, so I'm going to, but as I was just saying earlier, literally, the event was so good, I do literally have withdrawal symptoms. I am actually just thinking, I am thinking, damn, this time last week, I was in Florida. Or literally, it was Saturday, I was thinking, this time last week, it was Marvel Teams, or this time last week, your head was getting shaved.
Oh, God. Hey, man, it was a very... I'm happy it got shaved, to be honest. It's so hot out, I don't care. But I'm having withdrawals, too. I actually wish CEO 2014 was tomorrow, because I actually made a lot of mistakes this year with running it, but nobody noticed. Nobody cared, because they were having so much fun. But when I correct those mistakes, next year is going to be even better, and I can't wait to do it again.
Oh, no, for sure. Again, we'll get onto those points. We'll get onto those points later. But again, just getting back to... about Florida. I think as I was explaining before, this was the first time I ever left my country, so it was a bit of a culture shock. The first thing that greeted me in Florida was the weather, because I did look ahead at the weather. I thought, oh, it's only 32 degrees, because we've had 32 degrees in London before, but I failed to ignore the humidity was 90%, because you know our humidity is like 30, maybe 40%, but the minute I got off, just left the airport, it was like...
Yeah, no, I'm used to it, but this summer actually has not been that bad compared to others. In Florida, yeah, man, it has not been as hot as they usually is. I think the world's coming to an end with global warming and all that crap, but you got lucky. This year wasn't so bad. So plus, it rained a bit, so it kind of cooled down and everything.
Yeah, about the rain, it's like I even overheard people talking like, yeah, when it rains in Florida, it just suddenly comes out of nowhere. I just thought, yeah, when it just suddenly sort of monsoon rained out of nowhere, I just thought, funny, the last time I saw this rain was in Sin City, and that was like fictional.
Right, yeah, I know, it comes and goes and it's done, so that's Florida. You get used to it. I mean, I would rather live here than live somewhere up north where you're stuck in your house because of snowstorms. And I know it snows in London, doesn't it?
Not that often. I think this last winter it did. And well, yeah, when it snows in London, it's pretty bad, because it's like if we just literally get about 4 centimeters of snow, London shuts down. It's that bad.
Right. Yeah. Well, I've been to London actually twice before. It's been many years, but I remember when I went, it was cold. But yeah.
But London certainly does get cold. But yeah. But again, the event itself. I mean, I don't even. Again, it's like, where do I even start? I'll be honest. I knew this event was going to be good, because obviously there was no way in hell I would put £1,100, which, well, as you know, the pound is a bit more mightier than the dollar, to go to an event. I knew that wasn't going to be great. But what I didn't expect was, again, I got everything I wanted, because you know I came there for three different reasons. I came there obviously as a fighting game player. I came there as a content maker, you know, looking for interviews, and kind of as a document. So I was doing three things at once. I did not expect that all three of those areas would just be greatly exceeded. I mean, you know, simple things like I didn't expect you'd allow anybody to get into the ring. So when you Alex said, yeah, get in the ring, it's like, really? And then, you know, you sort of encouraged me the next day, saying, oh, yeah, it's going to be the big finals days, and next days, you know, just get in the ring, get all your... And I was really surprised, because a lot of TOs I've met when I'm filming stuff, they're saying, yeah, careful where you go. Yeah, are you going to be here or are you going to be over there? So, seriously, it's like...
I trusted you. I knew, and I wanted to give you an opportunity to do something you've never done before, so that's why I did it. I mean, next year I will have to limit how much media is in there, because the camera guy himself was like, there's too many people in here. So obviously I got to limit how that is, but I mean, I didn't see – you didn't cause any problems. Every time I wanted my chair, you got right up. So you knew your role.
Yeah, fair dues, because it's your event. It's your damn chair. It's like, of course I would move out of the way. Actually – what was the name of that camera guy? Because
Tony, he's awesome. He is ZCLYC. God, his name's impossible unless I look it up on Twitter. I freaking hate him. It's ZCLYH3, Tony, on Twitter. Yeah, no, he's awesome. I brought him out from California because I've seen him at all the events. And
California? Bloody hell.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I flew like 5 people from California. The stream team's from California. So, yeah. And, you know, a lot of events, they don't like to everyone has a very tight budget because we are still community run. But I will say those guys that I do bring out, they make the event possible for the stream and everything. And without them, the CO wouldn't be the complete package or like with Yipes for the entertainment. So I do take care of the people that I know will add a very beneficial fun factor to the events. That's why I do it. So, yeah. He came all the way from California. He was worth it, and I'm glad he had the time to do so because he'll be doing Evo next week or this week. So a lot of guys that get involved with CEO are a part of Evo, and for good reason. They're the best of the best.
Oh, my.
Yeah, was it true that you flew Yipes all the way out?
Yeah, I mean, it wasn't that expensive from New York, but things happened at the last moment. He couldn't come out, and I said, I'll take care of you. And I brought him out, and he was the best thing for the event. So he is on my VIP list every year. Because he worked, man. I mean, he puts in work. Anybody that can commentate, I think, deserves to be compensated. Obviously, as long as you have the funds to do it, you know, you shouldn't go broke. If you don't have the money to take care of people, they'll know up front, hey, could you just help me out? And obviously, they won't care. But if I make money, I like to take care of everyone else before me. Because first and foremost, it's not about the money to me. It's about putting on a good event. And obviously, because I put on a good event, I made money from doing it. So everyone's happy. So I'm happy with how things turned out.
That was the good thing about bringing Yipes, because him and his pillow brought the hype.
Oh, yeah. That was my pillow, actually. I had to sleep in the room one of the nights because one of the guys couldn't make it. So I actually slept in the room overnight for like 5 hours. Then my friend came and took over, and I went and showered and came back. And during the event, you could see me sleeping. Somebody had a picture of me sleeping in the crowd for like a good half hour. So
You can talk to Skirmish about sleeping at events.
Yeah, that was... Yeah, that was a different different circumstances. Essentially, at a certain Scottish major, basically, I fell asleep, and apparently there's like about 1,000 pictures of me sort of dozing off, and now there's all the gifts, and now it's like does Skirmish dream of electric sheep and rubbish like that?
Right.
But no.
I was gonna answer the question. Willow asked, "Where did I get the anime pill? I got that from Amazon." I couldn't find a Persona character, so I just got the first one that came to mind.
Ah, gotcha then. But again, yeah, just talking about the event itself, and again, the fact that I was overwhelmed. As a matter of fact, again, if I went there purely for media roles, I could have done that. But again, I sort of wanted to go there as a player, so then I could experience how you ran things, how you did, and it was like, I was really shocked. I had this misconception that perhaps you'd have loads of staff. It's not a negative thing or anything. It's like the way you run your event is not really too dissimilar to how we run our own event. It's exactly how what you say on the tin. It's community effort Orlando. And it was all highly motivated staff that were just running around like headless chickens. It was, yeah.
Nice. Oh, look, Kotaku posted a positive article. I love it. I'm working with them now to make sure they start posting good stuff, so I'm glad. Because all you got to do is communicate, man. I'm sick of all the rivalries and all the behind-the-scenes talk. I'm just going to make everything a better place. That's it.
What, is it the article about Dominion?
No. They're working on that now. I had to get them more info on that. When I played the 7-year-old, King Ray Jr.
Oh, yes.
Oh, yeah. So. Oh, that kid's a
beast. I really enjoyed that.
Okay, but yeah, like I was saying, it was the fact that it kind of fills me with hope, because I was always thinking that the way the Americans do things would be, I wouldn't say, I don't know, without trying to sound bad, I don't know, esports-ish, but it was like, I was surprised. It was like the way you ran things was just pretty identical to how we run it at home. It's like, it is indeed just community members, and it was like, I didn't actually realize that the guy running my pool was actually Frankie G, because I heard of that name. He was a Marvel player, thinking it was only until after, you know, he was in the ring, I realized, wait a minute, that guy was running the pools.
Yeah, and honestly, when I first did CEO, I mean, I ran everything. I remember the first CEO, when we had 3 weeks of planning, I ran the entire 128-man bracket by myself, no joke. So I was running back and forth, And then the next year I ran a bit, but then people started to step up. Like, it's hard for me to assign tasks because I still have trust issues. But this year was the first year I had no hand in registration other than adding people to pools. But registration was handled by Slendy, a great girl in Orlando that's been helping me out with all my events, and Mike Schumann. He's like my right-hand man. But now I've really assigned tasks to other people, so it's a lot less stress. Last year was actually no stress at all. This year was kind of stressful because I made a lot of mistakes, so the schedule ran way behind on Sunday. But it worked out. Everyone there had fun. Obviously, the people at home were getting tired watching on stream. But, without everyone's help, this year would not have been possible. Otherwise, I probably would have killed myself with all the stress. But, it really does take a community. And without these guys, they wouldn't have been possible. But now, like I said, because the event's been profitable and making money, I took care of everybody on food for lunch and dinner. I got Popeyes, sushi, Subway, and then one other one. Sushi, Subway. And pizza, obviously. So I like to take care of people.
Oh, yeah. I definitely saw that because when Tony, the reason why I wanted to ask who that cameraman was, I just saw him there all the time. He was just in that ring all day. He didn't miss a shot, because I certainly missed tons of shots when I was doing some stuff. And it was like, yeah, and he was just there all the time. It was just mad. It was just all the the guy definitely was a proper trooper. And again, I saw you just reach into your wallet. You just grabbed I don't know what you grabbed out, but you said, yeah, go help yourself to some food and stuff. And it was like, you take care of your staff, so damn.
Well, they take care of me, so it's only fair.
But where was I then? Yeah, about I guess we can cover the point now. The only bad which really probably happened to the event was it ran a bit late. But as you say, I kind of overlooked that because normally because again, the problem is where we come from. Yeah, hence the very reason why my show is called Tournament Standard Time. That is essentially what FGCs are across the pond as well. Our events, they do run late as well. But oddly enough, I kind of didn't mind because the thing you've got to understand is our events, they're not really that big. I mean, some of our events, they have not really broken 100 people in like the last 2 years and they still run late. But the fact that you've had, about 800 or so people and it just ran late by a similar margin...
What it was honestly trying to stream too much, man. Next year, I'm going to take more focus on the people at the event and not the stream because I'm trying to do top 16 AE. It's impossible. You have to, which was my mistake. It was nobody else's fault but my own. But I tried to do like top 16 AE on Sunday and all that stuff. So next year, I'm sorry, stream monsters, but if you want to have the most fun, you got to come to the event. I'm going to focus on, only winner side matches on Saturday night for the semifinals for like the big games like AE Marvel and get them out of the way. Because what happened was on Sunday, and it was great. I was like, guys, we're running out of time. I need AE matches to run off stream for about an hour before I thought, oh, shit, JT never took down a second stream, so let's throw the matches on there. But it was at the point where I remember where everyone, literally like 50 people were gathered around one monitor to watch these semifinals matches, and it was awesome. It was just like this was the time before there were streams where everyone was there, excited and hype, watching their close friends play right there on the spot. And I'm just like, man, if only it could always be like that. But, we got to cater to the stream now and make sure everyone at home watches it. I mean, as much as I pick on the stream, it was amazing to see people tweet me like, this is the last time I'll ever stream Monster. I'm coming to CEO next year. So it has its benefits, obviously. So it was great that I streamed as much as I could. We did it a lot more than I expected to, but next year it really is going to be more focused on scheduling for the event in person, making sure all the finals are ready to go, because I honestly think the crowd would have been so much better if they weren't so exhausted waiting around, because we had some hiccups. But next year it's going to be just like Evo does it so perfectly. Sunday finals day, they get rid of all the games in that main hall, and they just set it up for people to watch, and that's why the crowd gets so into it, because there's no other distractions, and they're a part of that hype. So I kind of want to build on that. I think the success of CEO is people getting to practice for Evo and all the casuals. So like on the schedule, I had 4 p.m. All casuals will stop Sunday. I didn't end them till 9 o'clock because I saw people were having fun, and I didn't want to stop the fun. So you just got to focus more on the event, the people attending, because they're the ones giving you their hard-earned money, traveling around. But again, nobody complained. They enjoyed the stream, so everything worked out somehow.
Okay. yeah, we're going to finish off my bit, and then we can get straight onto your topics, which I wrote out nice and orderly. But it was like, yeah, besides running late, the only negative, but I think you've already addressed it, was, yeah, there was kind of a lack of space. But although I can definitely say that was not due to the players, it was due to the fact that so many people were bloody spectating, because it was like an injustice. Literally, there was, god damn, there was almost like 100 people crowded around watching, watching like Tom Brady or like Rio play and stuff like that. And that kind of, I don't know, that's kind of an interesting school of thought, because people like the fact that our FGC events are their open events that you could just walk on and spectate, you know, that's it, because there's no separation, you know, from the players. But at the same time, it's kind of a detriment to the event if literally you can't move around, isn't it?
Yeah, I mean, this year the attendance was insane. I was overwhelmed. I could not believe that, you know, 3 years ago we had 300 people. This year we had over 1,900 people. I was shocked. You know, thanks to everybody helping out. But yeah, I mean, that's why I have to get more space for next year. I mean, a lot of events run in smaller venues and everything works out in the end. But I'm just like, wow, I already have to get another ballroom, you know, so I'm really it's a good problem to have. So I just think next year I might feature a few less games. There are just so many games out there to feature as main events, it's impossible to do anymore. And I think that kind of scares off new players from getting into the fighting game scene, because they have so many choices. So when they go to a tournament for the first time, they're like, which game do I play? Is that game? You know, they don't know how to assume what's the game they'll want to play more. So if you give them a few less games to choose from, or even something like Dive Kick, crazy to say, they'll get interested because it's easy to get into. So I think that's the future of tournaments.
Real talk. Dive Kick was a damn excellent game, because again, there is a lot of negativity in that game. I mean, I don't blame them, because it's true to say it's not, you know, a lot. What the hell?
Sorry.
I don't have any pets. That's not me.
That's my message to him again. I'll put on silent.
Dive Kick is actually a damn fine game, and it's because I've actually played it. I mean, it's true to say it may not be that fun to watch, but when you actually play it, it's like, oh my god, you get it. It's like, it's so pick up to play. And well, what more should you ask? And you know, you're in the game, and funny enough, you're my favorite character, which is kind of ironic.
Thank you. Yeah, it really is a great game. It comes out hopefully soon. They haven't announced a date yet, but yeah, I mean, it had the fourth highest turnout out of the 11 games I hosted, so you got to give it credit. You know, whether people like it or not, that game has potential, because it is so easy to get into, and people just, it's a quick game. I love a game where you don't even need to bring your own stick. It's already there. You're good to go. So hopefully we see a lot more of that. I know it's going to be at Evo for people to try out, and I'm just excited for people to get to play with my big head.
Does any of you guys know what that baseball game was called? They played at one of the tournaments.
Fatal League. Yeah, that was at UFGT.
Like, actually needs to be there.
Oh man,
that was pretty hot.
Okay, but just to wrap up this point, because that's those were the.
Give me 1 second, guys. I have to speak to my mother. One moment.
No worries.
Hey, mom. Hello. Mom.
Actually, while I have a few spare time while he's talking to his mother, I'd like to make a quick plug. Doom had asked me to. Over the weekend in Ireland, we're having both a tournament and an all-nighter for Evo. On the Saturday, we're having a tournament for Super Street Fighter 4, Marvel, Injustice, and Smash, actually. So obviously that'll be a good tournament, and all the footage will be uploaded to Dr. Doom's YouTube channel, which is youtube.com/BrianVonDoom. And also, if anyone, you know, is in the Dublin area and also like to attend, we're also having an all-nighter on the finals night of Evo, where we are renting out the XGC, having a bunch of machines for casuals and a bunch of setups for the stream, and we're just spending all night having a blast watching the stream, playing casuals and whatever. So, and I'm pretty sure there are going to be a couple of, like, we're having a couple of First to Five stuff like that will be recorded as well, also put up on Doom's YouTube channel. So just to give a plug to that, in case, you know, anyone is interested in coming to Ireland or is in Ireland for that weekend, whatever, please check out our forums on boards.ie.
Sounds like a good time to be in Ireland by the sounds of it.
And I'm back.
That was perfect time.
Yeah, perfect timing. But yeah, just to wrap up the last point, yeah, because those were the only two negative points, which was, it was running late and the lack of space. But again, but as you say, you're going to get a new ballroom. So if I'm collect, so just to confirm, is it going to be like the same setup? It's all going to be in one larger ballroom, or is it just going to be like a separate ballroom?
It's going to be the same big ballroom. That's the big one. Then I'm getting a second ballroom, which I might host another game or another one or two games by themselves that they'll take care of. I'm not ready yet, but I mean, I kind of want to bring Smash back. So we will see how that goes, if any of their community can step up, because obviously I can't be in two ballrooms at once. But if people step up and they want to run their other games, I'll be glad to host it. They're adding three new ballrooms. I could only add one more unless I could book the whole hotel, and I'm not ready for that kind of risk yet. But if next year is as big as I think it can be, then who knows, in 2015, I might even need a whole new hotel that has a bigger ballroom. Because that ballroom you're in is 19,000 square feet, which is pretty big. It's the second biggest of any FGC event behind EVO, which is massive. Theirs are 60,000 square feet. So
The EVO event's been moved to Bally's, is it now?
It's at the Paris, but they have like a joined convention center between the two. And I saw when they first, obviously I'm a curious guy, as soon as they announced, I went looking to see how much space there was, and it's pretty freaking humongous. So yeah, obviously they had to get
Facebook of it. It's actually quite a big event. They had like a wrestling tournament on a summit over there, so it looks like a really big venue, pretty much the same size as last year's EVO from what I can see anyway.
I think it might be bigger and adding the other space, but it's a lot closer together. I remember last year at Caesar's Palace, a couple of the ballrooms were a little bit of a walk. But, I'm really excited. I go every year to support the event. I also go to compete. I've been practicing all week. Now that CEO's done, I can play games again.
Okay.
So you main in there? So what's like your main game that you're mainly focused on?
Street Fighter 4 is still my biggest game. I use Balrog.
Okay.
Cool. Okay. Yo, guys, I just realized something, because... Mr. Alex Jebailey just joined up. I didn't actually introduce my two co-hosts, so like I said, so you are talking to Goukifafa or Mr. Matthew Harrison, and oddly enough, he's actually going to EVO, so you might actually bump into him.
Yeah.
Just look for me. I'll be all over the place.
All right, we'll do the
look for the big bald head.
Okay.
Yeah.
And the guy with the Irish accent, that is Mr. Bento Sento, and he's from the Emerald Isles. So I've got a nice. Yeah.
We had somebody from Ireland, Chris O'Shea. He came out this year.
Yeah. I
can't say I know him.
Oh, you do?
I can't say.
Oh, darn. Yeah, okay, because I met that D. Yoshi guy from Australia, and obviously I bumped into Ryan Hart again. And yeah, because I heard there was an Irish guy, but I never bumped into him, so I guess, damn. Because, as you were saying, it was a pretty international event, the CEO this year. You had 16 countries, wasn't it?
16 to be exact, which, like I said, is shocking, because the first year we had four states in America, and those were all states people drove from. So it was a pretty big increase. So that's why I go out of my way to make sure everyone that comes from all over the world spending their really hard-earned money gets the best damn show they can get.
Okay, excellent. But anyway, we can now get onto your topics, and again, it wraps up nicely to the second half, and... Yeah, this is a question I like to ask all my guests, because again, it gives us a good idea of the person, because it was like, discovering things like our worst Keith ever, Mr. James Baldoff, was an arcade player. So I'm just curious, what is your origins with competitive fighting games, Mr. Alex Jebailey?
The first one I really played, honestly, was Street Fighter 2 back in the day.
Oh, excellent.
And Mortal Kombat. I've been around for years. I have two older brothers that they don't play anymore, but back in the day, they brought home a Nintendo, and I think the first game I ever played was Street Fighter 2. Being 30 years old, I wasn't around when Street Fighter 1 came out. I was too young for that, but I played a lot more Mortal Kombat, actually, than I did Street Fighter in the 90s. I mean, once Mortal Kombat 1 and 2 came out, that's all I went to the arcades to play. I used to actually hustle. I would take my sister's word processing machine, because obviously there was no computers then, with Microsoft Word. And I would take a word processing machine, and I would type out the fatalities and the codes, special moves, print them out, and then take them to the arcades and sell them to people. Because my brother had Prodigy Net, and that was right when, like, the internet, like, there was nothing. There was no forums or anything. I would look up the codes with his help, and I would type them out, and that's how I became such a fast typer. I don't even use the right method. I use my own way of typing. And it was because I used to type out the code, sell them at arcades for like $5 a pop, and that's how I made the money to go play games and stuff. But, I mean, I used to have very good connections with a lot of arcades. They would give me free tokens just to play because people were spending their money trying to beat me at Mortal Kombat 2 and 3. And I used to place bets with idiots on Mortal Kombat 3 Ultimate, because I could actually beat the game blindfolded completely, and I would bet them, I bet you $10 I will beat Mortal Kombat 3 blindfolded right now. They're like, no way, no way. And what? I would do it with the cheapest tactic in the world, which is you jump back with smoke, you hit low kick, and every time you do that, the computer would always throw a projectile, and I would hear the projectile, and then I would do his teleport move into combo. Rinse, repeat the whole way through. And my friends would just laugh at the people losing their money to me doing this stuff. So I always used to get crowds, but I played a lot of that. Now, for the actual FGC, because in the 90s, there was no scene in Orlando that I was aware of. I didn't get into it until CVS2 came out, Capcom vs. SNK2. And I remember the first time I ever played that game was with a friend of mine, Trent, at college, and we had a machine in our college arcade. And I used to sit there for hours on end playing, and that was the first game I played, and then I started going to tournaments for that game. I never played the Alpha series in arcade. I always played it on, like, PlayStation 1. So that was...
used for CVS 2?
I'm sorry?
What team did you use for CVS 2?
When I first played, I used N-Groove. I used Vega, cheap team. Vega, Blanca, Sagat was like the first team I went to tournaments with.
Yeah, Sagat, must have Sagat, yes.
Yeah, and I knew how to roll cancel. It took me a little while, but I knew how to roll cancel.
Skank.
But then I switched to K-Groove. Now if I ever play, I use Hibiki, Cami, Blanca is my main team. With Blanca Ratio 2, unless I play against certain characters, then I go Hibiki Ratio 2. She's my best character.
Wow, yeah. that's a pretty technical character.
She's got that really ambiguous cross-up. Is it jumping first punch?
With who? With her?
With Hibiki, is it?
Yeah.
With the fierce kick. Yeah, you can jump over with a fierce kick and then finish with a low short into slice. CVS2 is still my favorite game of all time. Street Fighter 4 is really a close second now. Obviously, I put more time into that, but CVS2 is what it all got started, and then I started hosting tournaments. I actually used to play DDR, Dance Dance Revolution, or a skirmish would probably say Dance Dance Revolution. DDR. Anyway, so I played that and ran tournaments for that and stuff and competed and did a few other things DDR related I don't like to talk about anymore. I ran DDR tournaments, then I ran CVS2 and Third Strike tournaments, which I also played. I played Marvel 2 very little, but I played a bit of it. CVS2 was the game to get me into the FGC. And then when everything kind of died out in like 2004, 2005, where there was no new games coming out, it was just quiet. I switched to competitive card games like Versus System, if anyone remembers. And then 2008 came out, Street Fighter 4 came, and that's what changed everything and what got me back into hosting tournaments, and then I built it from there.
Wow. Okay, so...
So you went from an arcade hustler to a TO.
Pretty much. I think that's what every TO did. Every TO I know... from the Final Round guys to the West Coast to ECT, we were all players, man. We all started out as players. Even the Cannons and Mr. Wisner, all of them, that's how they started. They start out with a small tournament in an arcade, and that's how Evo got so big. So to be successful, you have to have roots in the scene. Otherwise, you won't survive. Seeing guys come in here just for the money. Like, how much money do I need to, okay, I'll make this from that. So if this many people come, okay. But they don't understand the games they're freaking hosting, so... Everyone that organizes now, they understand what they're doing because they are a player first and foremost.
Damn. Okay. Whoa. Okay.
Next question.
Yeah, I guess so. I mean, yeah, we'll get on to the point of why I call you the People's Tournament Organizer, and I might actually have to go to the trouble of actually building you an award and sending it all the way out to Florida, because...
Okay. My address is 81. No, I'm just kidding. Go ahead.
Okay. In all honesty, again, I said it in the cool interview that I did that I posted up the other day, and it was like the fact that you just replied back yourself. Yeah, emphasis on the word yourself within just 3 minutes. Because again, I've worked with people who, in all honesty, don't even deserve to be even called tournament organizers. Literally, you even ask these people, "Is your event still going on?" They won't even respond, and it was like it was left up for people like me, because I was like the streamer for them, saying, "Yeah, the event is still going on because I'm streaming for them." So it's like literally, the fact that you yourself would personally answer what was a pretty mild, you know, minor email. It was like something as silly as the hotel's all booked up, isn't it?
Right. I mean, that's customer service. If you don't have customer service, then nobody's going to be happy with your service. Just plain and simple. But it's easy for me. I mean, my day job gets busy at times, but I have a lot of free time to be on my phone. And if anybody's ever, if you ever see me on my phone, I can type. People say I deserve a world record award for how fast I can text and type. But it's easy, man. I like to stay connected. I mean, sooner or later, I'm going to have to disappear and fall off the map. And then I'm still going to be getting questions every day. But with my day job, I have to answer questions as quick as possible because that's what continues to bring good business and stuff. So yeah, man, it's just, you have a question. How hard is it to read and write? You know, if you know how to read and write, then you're set. That's all you need to do.
Because again, it's like, I saw you run around your event. It was, you must have the patience of a saint. Cause it was like, you know, even silly things like, yeah, during the middle of the event, I actually lost my phone. Well, actually I didn't lose my phone. I actually left it under the table, funny enough. So I kind of panicked. Hence why there's no footage of me covering the KOF finals. Cause I actually genuinely thought I lost my phone. But it was like, yeah, you know, I asked, I told you I lost my phone. You were just straight on it. It was like, has anyone seen a phone? And it was like, again, you know, if it was any other tournament organizer, it'd be like, you know, leave me alone. You know, that's your problem. You've got to sort it out. So it's like, really, it's like, and again, it was, you were always being pulled apart like 1,000 different directions. So,
I mean, I think we found like 7 phones and I had 2 wallets brought to me and I deal with millions of dollars in my day job a year, not every day. I don't want people to rob me anymore. But like, you know, I see credit card numbers all the time. So I had, my registration was horrible this year. I used a new system and it was a total failure. And I had to have people calling me over the phone with their credit cards. And they're giving me their credit cards like, dude, I don't know why, Jebailey, but I trust you. I'm like, no. But I just, here's the truth. My first tournament CEO, somebody actually stole my iPhone from my own event.
What?
So in CEO 2010, damn. Some asshole stole my phone, and we still don't know who. And I remember I had to leave Sunday morning to go get a new phone because me without my phone is like a freaking chicken without its head. And so after that day, I'm like, man, if I ever catch a thief at any of my events stealing anything, I will literally go to jail because of what I'm going to do to them. And I don't care if people stream it or whatever. Like, I just hate theft. It happens at every event. So as soon as people brought up wallets to me, I'd right away be like, hey, somebody lost your wallet. Come find Jebailey. So, I mean, being the fact that I'm really tall kind of helps to find me easier in a tournament. But, you know, I want to help, man. When it makes somebody's day, if they lose something, they're stressing out. But if they find it, they are, like, so relieved. And then you look at it and be like, look, idiot. Pay attention next time. Don't let it out of your, you know, your sights. But, you know, like I said, my phone got stolen. I couldn't believe it. And I want to make sure if that ever happens to somebody else, I can do my best to make sure they get it back. So.
That's nice, man.
Like I said, the people, definitely the people's TO. And, yeah, going on to this. I mean, yeah, this next point is, you're like, again, you're one of the few TOs I know, or probably one of the, few TOs I definitely know that where, you put a face to your tournament because, you know, everybody, yeah, the minute people say Alex Jebailey, they say, CEO, because that's kind of a gutsy thing to do, because obviously if your event kind of goes tits up, it's all on you. But it's a case that your events have ran so well, you know, you kind of done what, let's say, Richard Branson has done. You know, you've kind of given CEO, you know, a proper face, you know, a brand, as it were.
Right. I mean, I'm really fortunate that people trust me and believe in me. So it kind of works. I mean, I'm proud to be the face of it. Obviously, there's a lot of guys that make it work. It's not just me doing everything. So I wish I could get their faces out there, but some of them like to stay behind the scenes. And they're like, Jebailey, you just take all the credit. I don't care. You know, as long as I get to help, that's what matters to most people. But I mean, it's easier to be responsible and stuff. Like, there was incidents that happened that I had to leave the venue for a bit and go talk to hotel management. So there was one point, I think it was like Saturday around 6 o'clock when pools were done and semis, there was literally like a line of people to ask me something, like 10 people in a row. Okay, what do you need? Okay, see ya. What do you need? Okay, see, you know, so, and that's why I never answer my text, because it would be a staff member texting me with a problem, come here, and instead of replying, I would just show up to wherever they were. So that's the benefit of all being in one ballroom. You can have easier access. But yeah, man, I just like to be helpful where I can. Obviously, I use CEO as a platform to bridge out and hopefully host other events and stuff, because people will, you know, I let my events speak for myself. I've had I've had trolling incidents. People know me as a big troll online, but at the end of the day, people come to my event. They see the fact that I'm all serious when it comes to the event, and if they enjoy the event, then everything will follow through.
Have you got a favorite moment of your recent CEO tournament?
Ooh, one second. Can I help you? My buddy's here. The Smash players are coming. Let them in. Make sure to spray them down with Febreze before they walk in. Okay, I'm sorry. I mean, there was so many moments. My personal moment, obviously, even though I lost in Dive Kick, because Markman plays that game every day, and that was the first night I played in forever. Playing King Ray. Well, that's a good picture. You got to send that to me. Just Photoshop out the gut.
Okay.
what you would call it. Playing King Ray, the kid Ray,
oh, yeah,
he is really good at Tekken. For his age, he is actually good. I had to go to solo mode because I forgot the combos. And if I didn't switch to solo mode, I probably would have gotten destroyed. So the only way to keep up was go to solo mode. And I did not let up. I was playing my best because I'm really rusty at Tekken tag, to any of the Tekkens. But just, you know, that was a great moment, seeing that kid really happy. Mike Ross ripping up the cage, I was like, perfect, somebody's going to do it, and it's the best that he did it. So, you know, a lot of moments.
King Ray Jr. is only like 7 years old, wasn't he?
He is only seven. Yeah, last time we played, he was six. Damn. And I beat him. I showed him no mercy, and the whole time everyone in the crowd was like, effing bully. So this was at one of my smaller events. So his dad really wanted me to play him again so his sister could watch, the kid's niece. And I was like, I got to find time, you know, give me time. And at first it wasn't going to happen. And then Tekken ended, and I'm like, okay, we got 10 minutes. Let's do this. And he was just so happy I did it. So, you know, if I lose, it's okay as long as it's at an expense. I mean, I don't know if you saw my match with Jace the Ace, who got top eight. We went to the very final hit. So that showed people I do know how to play, which is one of my favorite moments. And I hate losing, but, you know, a kid came all the way from California. He earned the victory. So I keep playing to make sure people earn the victory against me. I don't have the time to practice anymore, but the favorite moment had to be playing the kid on stream and seeing everyone enjoy it. So, yeah. And then losing to Markman, getting my head shaved, whatever.
King Ray's pop off when he won was just amazing. Just seeing him getting hype running around the ring.
Yeah, he was skipping. He was like skipping like a little boy, because obviously he is.
But he is.
Thought, yeah.
He was epic when he went up and high fived his dad. That was just amazing. I just love seeing shit like that. Just like little kids just enjoying the game.
That's what it's about. That's why I do CEO, just to show people how much fun it is.
I have to admit, it was pretty heartwarming because I did take pictures, and I just thought, oh my god, it's like a father and a little son at an FGC event. Because again, we really rarely see it our way. In matter of fact, I don't even know if I've even seen it at all down our way. So it was just, I don't know. When I see stuff like that, it just sort of gives me hope that there's hope for our scene yet. It isn't just the. Well, all the crap being reported on Kotaku, but anyway.
Yeah.
but just two more points before we get onto those question and answers, since, don't want to take you away from your Smash chummies.
No problem.
I was speaking to a couple of the guys, and they were concerned that perhaps the FGC, they're slowly going esports, because they were sort of pointing out how, even though the ring was your idea of it was a cool thing. Some people saw it as a way of separating the players from the spectators, which is kind of weird, but...
Not at all. That's completely wrong.
And the other thing was, there was a lot of ads everywhere, you know, like with the Red Bull, which was kind of weird, because I actually never got a chance to get any of those Red Bulls, because they were always empty by the time I got there. And obviously all those ads everywhere, and again, are we slowly going esports? Because the weird thing is, it's a bit weird because, you know, from our perspective, we're not even anywhere close to the sort of where you guys are at the moment. So it's just a bit weird that already some people on your side are saying we're slowly turning esports anyway. So you know, people complaining about MLG was kind of moot. So what do you think about that?
I mean, we're our own thing. We're doing successfully. I mean, MLG's tried fighters out in the past. It hasn't really worked out, but things could change in the future, obviously. But I mean, people that attended the event, that was the last thing on their mind, is this esports? No. They saw a great presentation. They enjoyed the event. So I don't care what people want to call it, whether they call it J Sports or, you know, or whatever. People enjoyed the event regardless of how it looked. So that's what matters to me. But I mean, we're our own thing. We have our own community. And uniqueness that can be different from esports. But at the end of the day, we are a competitive gaming scene. So I don't really like the term esports, but that's the best way to describe it. So if people think we're going that way, then they're probably not. They're probably the ones not attending the events to realize that whether it's esports or not, if there's hard work and good presentation into an event, everybody's going to enjoy it. So we got to grow up. Sooner or later, the scene's got to grow up from the grassroots into our own thing, and I think that's the way everything's going right now. So I have no problems with esports.
The thing is, though, about that, people, as I said, some people complain about it being more esports because the pairs are separated, yet from everything I saw on the stream and everything I heard from Skirmish, CEO looked like one of the most fun and kind of involved tournaments.
You have no idea. Because
look at the pictures. Are the players separated? No, they're not. They're all together.
They're all sitting in the ring.
It's just a stage. I mean, I use it, obviously, and a lot of people told me the ring is what separates me apart. And Evo's done a ring before when they had a Capcom event. They didn't really use it like a big projector stage. They just used it to have a lot of people in it to run the event because that's the only space they kind of had. But, I mean, I'm just doing it because I'm a wrestling fan, and a lot of the scene are the exact same age as me, and we came from the NWO and D-Generation X stage. I mean, I like it. It's become synonymous with CEO, so I kind of think I have to keep doing it every year. Sooner or later, I'll have to change into something bigger. But, yeah, it's a stage. I mean, I've seen a lot of players complain when they're at an event and the whole entire crowd's, like, literally right behind their chairs, and it's distracting. I mean, Daigo had a problem with that at one event. So anything that separates the players and spectators, but you're still in the same room, I don't see the problem. Plus, a lot more people are super hype in the crowd being, and it was a perfect viewing angle too. That's why, as you can see, there's a missing rope from the ring, because when the guy was putting on the rope that brought the ring, I looked down like, okay, that's going to shut off some people's line of sight, and we got rid of it, and it was perfect because it gave people an easier way to get in. Because I remember last year with the wrestling ring, they only have three ropes, and I was holding it up for all the players to get in and out. But yeah,
that's
man,
good idea.
I'm sorry,
I was just saying it's a good idea to get rid of it. It's like thinking ahead, so it's good stuff.
Yeah, like I'm a person, I cannot for the life of me, like I was trying to do the layout for the event and I'm like writing it out. I'm like, okay, I know I'm going to change something, so screw it. I'll just do it when I get there. And that's pretty much what happened. So I have a basic outline, like the stream schedule, the actual schedule I do plan in advance. But when I get to the venue, I move a lot of stuff. Like we move the cage over like 10 feet from somewhere else. So a lot of things I do it on the fly because I can't write it down. I have to visualize it and be there to do it. So the ring was a lot bigger than I expected, so we had to make a few adjustments, but it really worked out. I was really happy with how the ring looked, and a lot of people say when they walk in and they just see a big ring in a hotel ballroom, they're like, what the hell? So it's exciting, but I mean, look at those amazing pictures of just the players. It's just, you know, the players need to have no distractions and be focused on the game. That's why whether you have a stage, a ring, or whatever, you need the crowd to be behind them cheering them on, but out of the way of distracting them. So, and that's why I only have a one coach per player rule, which most events have that. There's one point where there was like three coaches on somebody's side playing against Chris G. I'm like, that's not going to help you. Why are you even wasting your breath?
The
players need to be comfortable, man. They need to be in a comfortable place to play and practice, and that's why a lot of tournaments, they have the headsets now and stuff, so they can listen to that. And even I use the headset when I play just so I'm not distracted. Or literally, I've had it, like last year, I was playing in my tournament match, and I had like three staff members coming up to me, hey, can you help me out real quick? I'm like, dude, get the hell away, you know, so... yeah, you kind of want to be separated from that stuff.
Gotcha. Yes, Matt, that is a Super Famicom, because besides the tournament itself, there was a lot of other stuff that was going around the tournament. So even if you went, even if you went 0-2, there was tons to keep you occupied. You know, Microsoft brought a booth. There was some sort of a ribbon-up game that was run by Red Bull. I've forgotten what the name escapes me, but it looked
cool. It was the X Couch, which I put my own system on. And then we had a Project Diva, Mike M, M-Song. He always brings that. I wanted him to bring it because I remember last year people were playing and were super hype about it.
Oh, here it is. Yeah, we got it right here. Yeah.
So Project Diva, which is and I love all music. There it is. Music rhythm games and stuff. And then on the right TV, I brought my souped up PS3 that nobody realized to turn on, which has a lot of games on it. So, whoa. Yeah, but no, that X couch was a great addition from Red Bull. They were going to bring me a really big DJ desk. I mean, like a super huge podium. They couldn't get it off the truck because the hotel didn't have a forklift. So I kind of wanted it there. And they said, we'll come back tomorrow with crates to bring. I'm like, you know what? It's going to take up too much space. Don't worry about it. But those barricades they brought me were a godsend. I loved them, especially to have players separated so they wouldn't bang on the ring itself. So that really worked out. But yeah, I had a lot of little props, man. Like the cage, the two extra TVs were there and the lighting weren't around the cage, it would have looked so stupid and dumb. But because those were there, it really added to the ambiance of the cage, and people seemed to really enjoy it. We didn't put the door on the cage. We were gonna put the door, but none of us could fit through it, so we kept it off.
Oh damn!
You know what was my only slight annoyance with CEO? Oh. It was that nobody entered the ring with some like Rhino's music playing, and they just ran straight up and slid in. That would have been so hype.
They're not athletic enough.
you miss Fighter Mania, where both Green Ace and
and PR Rog. They had really good entrances.
They had the best entrances ever. And it was like, there's probably going to be tons of footage, but I'm going to upload my one. And it was like, because I never heard of Green Ace up until that event. And, well, let's definitely say Green Ace represented Florida really well that day.
Yeah, this picture we're looking at now, this summarizes the FGC before streams. Everyone just watching a match, so into it. That's what's the best thing about the FGC, man. They could be two guys you don't even know, but if a crowd's watching them, everyone's going to be involved and super hype about it. So, go streams.
Okay. Yeah, just... All right,
It was actually things like that where people crowding around it that actually got me into going to tournaments. Because the first tournament I entered, it was like some shitty GameStop tournament. But the thing I loved about it was all the players are just crowding around in this small game, small shop, looking at the monitor, getting hype. That's what got me into the scene.
Right.
And I haven't turned back since.
I zoned out again. Kotaku-y.
Oh, God.
What, you haven't returned since because of something?
No. I haven't. No. Because of that whole, getting hype, I've won around the monitor. I haven't looked back since then, since...
Oh, of course. I mean, that's...
That's what hooked.
Okay. Anyway, that's just one last point before we can set the question and answers, and then obviously we can set you on your way, and it's been a nice show. We got a lot covered, and again, the revelation that you were an arcade hustler, and now you're selling... tickets to Disney World. I want to see the connection to this. I can't see it. Well, I can't.
Yeah, I know. Honestly, I have a great family that supports what I do. And if I had another job that wasn't the family business, I don't think CEO would be possible. It would be too much. But they support me. They give me the time off when I need it. So it really works out.
Okay, gotcha. Yeah, this is the last point, which again, this is just a recent topic. And what do you personally think about this recent spate of player donations? Because this is kind of an interesting topic. Because last year, I don't know if it was last year or the year before, we had a couple of our boys from the UK. They were able to go to Evo because of US donations. Because quite frankly, the Mortal Kombat scene in the UK is very tidy. We're like talking maybe just over a dozen people. I mean, I'm probably exaggerating, but it's a bit more than that. But it's like, so a lot of people from the MK community of America dug deep, and they got some of our best players. Useful Glue, Foxy Grandpa, Mustard Ketchup and Mustard out there. And yeah, I mean, I'm really cool with that. But recently there's been a spate of players who are, well, they're apparently they're sponsored, but now they're asking for donations. What do you think of that? Isn't that kind of
asinine? I mean, I wish I could be truthful on the matter, talking about sponsored players asking for donation drives. My buddy Jared's here, by the way. Sorry, I don't have my webcam hooked up. I mean, it is a shame that they have to do that. Getting to Evo is really expensive, and I know some top players don't want to ask for donations. I mean, I donated. Obviously, I'm a part of the problem, so to speak. But, I mean, if people want to donate, you have a choice. If you don't want to donate, don't donate, you know? You can't knock somebody, I wouldn't call it hustle, but things come up, things change. I know the same player that's being sent, he couldn't make it to CEO, and he took up a really great job offer, and I don't know if that's continued, and then he got some time to go to Evo. But if people want to donate, let them. It's their choice. You know, if they want to support somebody, if they want to support somebody, support them. That's all I have to say about that, really. Obviously, I wish there weren't donation drives, but I really think, and DJ Hoshin on Twitter posted a great point that I've been wanting to say, but I kind of have to take a step back and not get so involved with players personally anymore. But if you have a donation drive, you have to come up with some sort of way to give back to the people that help you. I mean, not so much pay them back, but even a special thank you to these people would make them feel so special. And I really think CO's success is because of all the appreciations I give out to all the little guys that help me that otherwise wouldn't be going to tournaments and stuff like that, and I'm always grateful for that. But I think if players do donation drives, they have to give something back. And hopefully that does start to happen now. But, I mean, again, Evo's expensive. I actually was unable to afford going to Evo this year until after CEO, because everything I own is tied up putting CEO on together, because you saw the hotel, and you can imagine how expensive that event is. So I told my dad, I'm like, I want to go, but I can't book it. And I was going to wait until CEO was over, but obviously the flights would be expensive. And all of a sudden, I get the first text I've ever gotten from my dad, who doesn't normally text, right? The first text I ever gotten, he goes, I booked you your flight to Las Vegas. Here's the details. And I almost cried. I was like, are you serious?
Oh, that's right.
So that was an amazing moment. Next day, I told him how much I loved him, and I was really grateful for that. But, I mean, not everyone's as fortunate. So, like I said, if somebody does a donation drive, if you don't like it, just don't donate. If you support that player because you like to see them and you appreciate what they do, then it's your choice, your decision. So I'll never tell anybody don't donate to somebody. But hopefully in the future that if this does happen again, players will start giving back some way. And I have a really cool video coming out this week that pertains to donations and stuff that I think the whole scene's going to freaking love. So stay tuned for that.
Okay. Anyway, time for the question and answers, and then we can set you free. Because again, I'm mad grateful. Because again, this is it's about 7 o'clock your time, isn't it? Because obviously it's about
7:30. Yeah, we're good. Don't worry.
Because it's like, well, obviously it's almost coming up to 1 o'clock here. So darn. But where was I? From Mr. Volkmeyer, who was the only person that actually. When I asked, were there any questions for Jebailey? Because we're now going to have to ask them on the stream. And his first one is, do you think, Mr. Volkmeyer, CEO Jebailey, do you think FGC events like CEO can get big enough to franchise, expand to other areas outside the USA?
Ooh, that's a good one. I know Evo tried to expand to Japan, but the earthquake situation happened, so that kind of changed things. I honestly don't think CEO would be a success outside of Orlando if I were to say, okay, let me do an event over here and see what happens. You really have to build into an area slowly. I would love to take the brand and host other events under the name like, you know, CEO Jebailey is hosting this event, but as to like invest and do an event in a completely new place, I think it's really tough. The first people that are really doing it, but it's within the United States, is the Fall Classic, where you have four of the biggest organizers besides me on the East Coast doing their own event in a completely new area, which I think is going to be a great success because that's four really big names putting an event together. But I think it's really tough to throw because obviously getting your equipment that you own, like I would say 30% of the equipment you played on at CEO was mine. I personally own 20 Evo monitors that I bought after winning tournaments. I would win, every time I would win like a Street Fighter 4 local, I would take the money and go buy an Xbox or a Evo monitor. So a lot of that stuff was mine. The rest was from Focus Fire, and then the community donated a bunch of stuff. But getting equipment out to a new location outside of the country is going to be way too expensive to do. It'd be really tough. But I can see partnerships happening with an outside event just to bring that name. But the problem with events, if you don't announce them early enough, people won't have them in their minds. A lot of people book at the last second, which is a big problem. But you know, if they know the event when it is, then they're going to plan for it. But doing it out of the country, I think, would be really hard. So I don't know if I would ever take the chance. But like I said, if it was another event and they asked for my help to be a part of it, I would gladly do that. But to bring all my own stuff and run it from scratch, I don't think is possible.
My God. So 20. Yeah, because I did. Yeah, because I was just counting the number of setups just to give us a rough average.
And 72.
Wow, 72? Okay, my numbers were wrong. I only counted 50, so damn.
Well, there was the dive kick area and then the other stuff, so yeah.
72 and 20 of them are your monitors, and you just, wow, paid for it out of, well, your winnings. Damn.
Pretty much, yeah.
Like I said, you truly are the people's TO, sir.
I know. I remember the tournament before CO 2011. There was a tournament in Tampa, and I won it like $400. And as soon as I won, I'm like, remember, guys, when I win, you all win. And everyone's like, oh, Jesus, shut up. yeah, so every time I win something, I give it back to the community. Because I'll be honest, I have 18 Xboxes now. I'm so jaded that I like try to give them away almost. Because I just have so many systems and stuff. So when I'm done with a tournament, if I don't want, like, here, just take it. I want to consolidate and stuff. I know that sounds cocky to say, but I'm just like, at this point, I just want to have people being able to play games as easily as possible. And that's why I just keep bringing all the equipment and stuff. But if I ever need help, if I didn't own any of those consoles, my community would so gladly help and bring everything. But it's a lot easier when you only have two people bringing everything than 20 people in case something happens. But a lot of the stuff, like the speaker system that was at the cage, Tiger, another organizer, brought. Another organizer, Mike from Orlando, he runs tournaments himself. He gave me 8 of his Evo monitors. So it all comes from the community. But you try to make sure that you have enough equipment to accommodate as many people as possible. Otherwise, if you have people waiting for hours to play on one station, it's not going to be a fun experience.
Okay, so they were your own setup. Because I noticed you had that Focus Fire guy there. And correct me if I'm wrong, aren't they a group that go around renting out equipment and sort of managing
your
stuff? Yes.
Yeah, they help with Evo's equipment this year, all the PS3s and monitors. He got me a job at YumaCon hosting. I see somebody asking a question about from Panda Manaman, I don't know, however you want to say it, about YumaCon stuff. But yeah, they host other events or they bring equipment too. So I've been working with them. I do pay to rent all their equipment, but they also bring their staff to run everything. So it's really worth the money.
In the future Evo's, do you reckon they'll ever introduce Xboxes as console setups? Because a lot of people experience problems with slowdown for like Marvel and even slowdown for Street Fighter 4 in certain cases.
Because you bucked the trend because you actually used the 360s for the Capcom games rather than all the other Road to Capcom events that have been using PS3s.
Well, a lot of other events changed to Xbox. I think hosting games in general is much easier on PlayStation 3. I'll just say that, especially with turning off controllers and stuff. But I've always hosted on Xbox since the beginning. I didn't care what other tournaments were doing. The first tournament I ever hosted, I had people vote. Would you rather play on Xbox or PlayStation? And it was 89 people that entered. 65 of them said Xbox. The rest, 24 of them said PS3. So what I did was I hosted both systems. And if there was ever a point where two players were from opposite systems, I had them play, or I had them flip a coin, and the loser had to play on the opposing person's system, but I would make sure to provide a controller or converter so they could play on it, and just from there, I decided to just stick with X. And I only had to do that 4 times, the coin flipping, and it only caused 1 problem. So from that point, I stuck to Xbox and just built it. In hindsight, I'm glad I stuck to Xbox, obviously, because it ends up being the better system. But like Injustice, I was going to host it on PS3, and then I play Injustice a lot. And I remember that one of the tournaments I went to, I played a match, and I threw a Batarang with Batman. And right after I threw the Batarang, I threw his trait bats out while my opponent threw an interactable. And the game slowed down so bad that I actually looked at my opponent and I go, we will not speak of this, because I still wanted to be on PS3. And I looked at him. He's like, oh, my God. And then I went and did a vote. I'm like, all right, what system does everyone want? And they went with Xbox. I'm like, okay, I agree. Xbox it is. And it worked out. I kept Mortal Kombat on PS3. But, I mean, Evo is such a big event. They've been sponsored by Sony before. Why would you change that in the middle of hosting your events? Obviously, the next generation could be a totally different picture. But only time will tell. It'll only be like 2 years before we have to decide Xbox One or PlayStation 3, because as much as I'm excited for Killer Instinct, coming out day one on a brand new system is not going to get the entire FGC to buy that system. So it's going to be really tough to see, but Sony's been a great partnership with Evo. They have no reason to change it up. And like I said, and I've been working with Xbox now. Microsoft works with me, and I have no reason to change it up either. Really, really, Skirmish, you're showing this video.
I'm sorry, that was one of the things that really endeared me to you, because a lot of people that follow my show know I'm actually a pretty mad eccentric guy. As a matter of fact, I'm actually pretty calm today, because normally I'd be pulling out all my replica weapons and stuff, because yeah, I'm called General Skirmish for a reason. So the fact that you don't take yourself seriously is really kind of endearing to me.
Yeah, no, that was perfect. I mean, Mark Man carries me, man. It was funny when we were in the cage doing the promos. I couldn't stop laughing, and he was so uncharactered. He's just like, "Come on, Jebailey, I can't carry you forever."
Yeah, I saw that when you were filming that. You guys couldn't stop cracking up.
Yeah. But he's an awesome guy. He's a big. There's two people that inspire me outside of the Evo organizers. It's Mark Man and Seth Killian. And me and Mark, man, dude, we could have such a hilarious rivalry together. So hopefully we do a lot more stuff. Okay, so that's it. Hold on 1 second. I'm sorry.
Okay.
Skirmish, make sure you ask Obake's question. That's a very good one.
Oh, yeah. Okay, guys, line them up, because, again, I don't want to keep...
Okay, I'm back. It was... I'm trying to take care of the scene, you know?
Okay. A question from Jebailey. Yeah, question for Jebailey. Obake25 asked Jebailey if he remembers a random Portuguese TO asking him for advice a few years back. Let him know he did help us a lot and our event became much better because of him.
Aw, that's sweet. Was his name Rafael?
No, it's Sergio.
Sergio. Yeah, and all the way in Portugal, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, I even wrote an article on CEOgaming.org about it to help him out, so... if you're watching, man, I'm glad it worked out for you. And anytime people have advice, if I have the time, I'll answer as fast as I can. So I just want to make sure everyone does a great event, you know? So I'm glad that worked out for him, because he did ask me. And I tell a lot of people that are just getting into the scene, don't go big overnight. CEO took two, 3 years before it got to where it is today. I did not go, okay, I'm throwing a huge event now, let's do this. No. Before the first CEO that I planned in 3 weeks, I hosted 10 monthlies back to back to back. So I was hosting tournaments and bars and stuff to build up to where I was like, okay, I think I can handle a really big event now, you know? So it doesn't happen overnight. You need the heart and soul to be put into this. Don't come into it thinking about the money. Think about the fun and the connections you're going to build with players that love the same thing and stuff. So, yeah.
Okay. Right, let me just trawl through some of these previous questions. So, anything else, guys? Blah, blah, blah.
Can you organize getting that Lethal League for Evo?
Yeah, well, I have nothing to do with Evo and their organization, but I saw it at UFGT, and I was like, wow, that game is hilarious. And I've actually always wanted to host a mystery game tournament. Wow. The only reason I don't is because Keats has somebody that specifically does all that, brings all his setups, and runs it. I don't think... if I asked, I'm sure I'd have people step up, but... CO is just such a grand scale, it'd be impossible to host that kind of thing in my own event as well.
Matt, Lethal League is actually a browser game. You can just go play it right now.
Really?
Yeah, just Google it.
I did not
Lethal
know
League. Yeah, I was playing it the other day.
Can someone paste me the link or something so I can save it?
I'll get it for you now. Hold on.
I'm going to be the Lethal League champion, I'm telling you.
Yeah, just keep talking, I'll find the link.
Okay, here we go. Okay, we got one from Willow. Okay, Alex, what would be your perfect wrestling entrance theme for you to enter the ring?
Well, I did the NWO one. I really Chris Jericho's entrance has always been my favorite. And I wanted to do Chris Jericho's and get little sparklers, but then I asked the hotel and I'm like, you need to get a fire marshal in the room, like just for sparklers. So I saved my money and did not do that. Yeah, no, Chris Jericho's has always been the best entrance. Goldberg is kind of like Chris Jericho's. But I went with the NWO theme because it fit perfectly with the CEO design and stuff, so I kind of stuck with that. And if you remember when I entered against Markman, that song is modified to say CEO, and that's actually my voice. So I had these great guys from UMVG make the song for me, and I recorded my voice, and I did the whole CEO, all that stuff. So, but Chris Jericho's entrance has always been my favorite.
Okay. Well, ask Adrift's question, he asked, is there something in the community that still embarrasses him? So, is there anything in the community that embarrasses you, Mr. Jebailey?
Man, there's so many things I really couldn't tell you. At this point, I used to be very shy growing up. I was an introvert. I did not talk to people. And then, you know, I fell in love with the FGC and stuff, and I became so passionate about it. It became so easy to do stuff. But, you know, if people laugh at my expense, I don't care. It really, you know, I've come to the point in my life where if people are, you know, entertained by you, do whatever it takes. But if people are picking on you and all that stuff, it's if that's what makes them feel better, better for them. But I just do my best. You know, I have fun with whatever I do. But embarrassing, no. Nah. I mean, losing to Mark, man, I should not have lost, but the guy has way more practice than me. That was kind of embarrassing to lose, especially when the whole crowd was cheering for me. But it worked out, man. Me getting my head shaved is much more entertaining. So
because obviously I'm just chopping up the footage now. The crowd were disproportionately on your side, because I was thinking, where the hell did all these little Jebailey pictures come from? It was like two.
Oh, that was me. I had a friend print them out, and I didn't mean to give them to the crowd, but he printed them out for me, and I forgot to get him the Twitch faces because I wanted him to do a couple Twitch faces in the crowd. I'm like, forget it. And then I gave out those. I'm like, watch them. Like, does anybody want these? Like, they were dying for the posters. And then some of them you saw, they got them signed by people. So that was really awesome feeling that it worked out for everyone's benefit. So, and those were printed from Mike. Tokel is one of the organizers. He does thefighterspirit.com. He's hosting an event later this year. So he was a big help. He provided those for me. And I got him out to everybody, and everybody kept them.
Oh, damn.
Jebailey, I have one from Ireland's very own Dead Eye Dave. He says, not a question, but tell Jebailey if he ever comes to Dublin, the entire Irish fighting game scene will go out drinking with him. Black Adam.
Oh, God. Will I come back to America alive or with liver failure?
Irish drink.
My favorite drink. My favorite drink when I go out with my buddies, we get Irish car bombs every time to start.
Oh,
the night.
That's my favorite drink at all. Damn.
I can handle like 5 Irish car bombs, then I'm done.
Oh, damn.
But no, I appreciate that. You know, I'm actually Middle Eastern, Lebanese. I was born in Canada, but I've been to Lebanon 13 times in my life, so I've traveled everywhere. Just my day, you know, I've put so much time into the FGC, I can't take vacation time anymore because every time there's an event, I have to use my vacation time on that. But one of these years, I'm just going to do CEO and then travel the world again. And I've heard how beautiful Ireland is, so I would definitely like to come out there.
What's the best tournament you've been to?
CEO 2013.
I knew he was going to say that.
Putting on. Oh.
No, okay, besides mine, Evo really is hands down the best. They do such they've been a huge inspiration to me. They do such a great job running everything. UFGT, though, if it's a non-Evo event, I have so much fun at UFGT. Just the people there are nice. Keats runs an amazing event. And it's just just like my event, there's so much to do when you're not in the tournament that you just have fun. And at the end of the day, you saw me playing against a kid, Mark, man. I just love to play. I don't care what game it is. I just want to sit down and play sometimes. And this event, I really had to take a seat back, which kind of hurt my pride, and not play casuals. But if you see me at other events, I am like nonstop money matching and, you know, playing as many players as I can. UFGT, if there's an event besides Evo or CEO that I would suggest to go to first, it's hands down UFGT.
Yeah.
Oh. Again, which I think I did say, and you always kind of strangled yourself. The original plan was for me to actually go to UFGT this year, but it was a case of ran out of money, and it was a case of there was only one other event that I thought I would honestly have much more fun, and that was, CEO, because, again, last year it was, you know, things like the belt or, you know, Justin Wong's, entrance was the Team America theme, which I'm kind of bummed out. You didn't play a game when it was Justin Wong versus Momochi or Margo.
You stopped talking. What, that was a question? I'm sorry.
Oh, sorry. Yeah. Oh. No, sorry. No, again, I was just saying, UFGT was originally going to be the event I was going to go to, and when I told that, you always kind of strangled yourself, but I was like, but no, it was only just because of how hype your CEO was last year that I just said to myself, well, the only other event I've got to go to is obviously CEO, and it was, you know, seeing things like, was it Justin Wong's, entrance was the Team America theme when he was...
Yeah.
I was really bummed out that you didn't play it again this year when it was Justin Wong versus Momochi or Margo, I think it was.
It was Momochi, I believe, yeah. And you know what? I remember when we had the Pokemon theme, the crowd sang to it. And then we had Richard Nguyen, who's like 15, 16 years old. He didn't know he wanted Dick in a Box because his nickname is Dick Nguyen.
Yeah.
And I'm just like, I looked at the songs. I'm like, dude, you can't play Dick in a Box. It takes too long for the punchline. Like when they hear it, they're not going to instantly go, okay, Dick in a Box is coming on. They're just going to be like, Wait, what is this? Wait, I think I recognize. Yeah, that's Justin Timberlake's voice. Wait a minute. Wait for it. Wait for it. Then it's too late. So we were like, okay, he's a kid. Freaking DuckTales. Do DuckTales. And it was funny because I was at PAX East, and they played the song, and they told the crowd, please sing along with us. And the screen even had the words so you could sing along. I didn't have to say shit at CEO. Everyone sang along to it, and I could not stop laughing with happiness so because everyone sang the song. So that was a really great feeling.
That cartoon was godlike.
It's impossible to not sing along to DuckTales.
I know. I can't wait for that. That game's a classic. So, okay. Plus, with Capcom streaming my event, that was perfect advertisement.
gotcha. Anyway, we got great.
Sorry, Skirmish, but I just gotta say, I think the favorite, the best entrance music of them all, and most fitting, was Flash Metroids.
What did he use?
He just Queen Flash on it.
Queen.
Because
apparently that wasn't actually his. That was the ongoing fear. Apparently, all the players requested theme songs and they didn't get them, and Flash apparently requested something else. I'm kind of curious what the hell that was. But anyway, this is a good question from the infamous Chunkus of Ireland. And Chunkus asked, in the future, will CEO be spaced further apart from Evo to increase the attendance of the event, or is it too far away to be a factor?
That's a very good question. I've had people tell me if I was farther from Evo that a lot more people would attend because they're being forced to choose. But June is just – it's a shame. I really hope Evo can find a way to be the end of July again or even the first week of August. But Florida in June is a perfect vacation time. I mean, having 1,900 people prove that there still is a shot of a lot of people coming here. So for now, I'm going to stick to June. We'll see how the next couple of years – I would love to work with Evo and hopefully they expand and, maybe even take over CEO or something. And that's just me thinking out loud. It's not anything that's happening. But Orlando is perfect in June. I have no reason to change it, so I'm going to stick with what works. And I used to be the middle of June, but I have to be away from E3 because during E3 a lot of my sponsors are there. So that's why I left E3 weekend this year. And also because that's Father's Day weekend, I had a lot of people complaining about Father's Day and stuff. So the end of June just happened to work out perfectly this year, and the crowd showed up for it. So for now, I'm sticking to June. I can't switch. I'm already signed for next year, but who knows in the future. If next year is bigger, then I have no reason to change it. So, and a lot of time, the majority of people can only afford to go to one big event every year, so they're obviously going to have to choose anyways. And the top players, they're going to be able to attend both anyways because they want the practice at CEO for Evo. Mm. And just on my own, Florida is such a huge scene that even if nobody came from out of state, I would still have 1,000 people attend CEO in Orlando. So, yeah. Okay. But I think it would be better if I was farther away. But again, it's working out for me. I can't change it.
Okay. Yeah, because apparently from what I heard, the hotel. Yeah, because you tweeted that apparently there was like 4 people that were already booking their rooms for next year because you already announced your date. Damn.
Yeah, I mean, I'm like, wow. And because they call me obviously after the event to check up on everything. But they call me like, we already have 4 people that have called us in the last couple of days to book for next year. I'm like, really? So they don't have it set up yet to get the rate because they're telling me like, yeah, we can't set it up till August because we don't do reservations a year in advance. And I'm just like, well, whoever the hell these people are, I want to shake their hands, damn. But I'm really excited for the hotel next year because all the renovations are done, construction's done. There's going to be 10 restaurants added right beside it. And you saw the venue. You walked right outside. You had Popeyes, McDonald's.
Oh, yeah, Popeyes.
Everything was there. So the venue is amazing. I don't want to leave it anytime soon.
For sure. Because again, if you're really hurting on a shoestring budget, again, you could, you can go to the fast food places, or you can go to the 7-Eleven and the little Kmart, which I've always wanted to go to. Because it's all those things you always see in American movies. You kind of think, is it sort of like a made up franchise? No, it's a real franchise. It's
that
a
was Walgreens. You mean Walgreens across the street next to a Checkers?
Yeah, something like that. Yeah.
Yeah. Same thing. You're same colors.
Yeah, because I always thought that was like a made-up sort of brand or whatever. I thought, oh my god, Kmart really does exist, because you got people calling themselves Kmart man and stuff like that. So,
right.
Wow, and again, it's just mad culture shock. They're a lot different from our convenience stores because it's a case of you can serve your own Slurpees and stuff like that. It's like, what the hell is a Slurpee? Yeah, I know, because we just call them. What the hell do we call them over here? Because we don't call them Slurpees. They're
Slush puppies.
I call them a slushie.
We call them slurpees or slushies.
Oh, okay. But yeah, that was it. And again, it couldn't prepare me for how huge those slurpees are. I was like, what the hell?
Oh, God. I know. I've heard about Europe and stuff. Like, your size large is like our size small.
It is. Yeah.
We're actually jealous. We want more.
Yeah, but you're actually thinner, too.
What's the old saying? Everyone's bigger in America.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, again, your food is definitely nice, but it comes at a cost there. Anyway, we've got one interesting question. So, again, if there's any last question before we send Jebailey, just line it up. But there was one question further back, and it was, here we go. From Mr. Life Aero, that famous YouTube celebrity. He asks, he's curious whether or not tournament organizers are wary or not about the Xbox One in the future or still plan to go with the PS4.
I mean, even though I'm sponsored by Microsoft, I'll always be honest. Right now, the PS4 is looking like the better system to run tournaments on just because of that Kinect requirement. That thing is huge. I mean, Have you seen Wii tournaments? You got to bring that freaking the Wii sensor bar everywhere. But the Kinect, I mean, that's like a $100 device right there you got to take everywhere. So you lose one, you're screwed. So I think it's really going to be tough. I know they're working on stuff to make it easier for tournament organizers, especially with a game like Killer Instinct. So it's still really honestly too early to tell. Mad Catz hasn't even announced anything for PS4 yet, but we know their Xbox One is getting stuff. But you know, if they make it easier to convert stuff and PS4 doesn't have the lag development issues, I really think PS4 is going to take over next generation. So, but I don't think we have to make a decision for at least another 2 years, thank God. Or at least when Street Fighter V comes out, if it comes out, whenever. It's probably going to come out like 2015, 2016, so. But I'm excited.
Okay.
Actually, I have a very important question.
Okay, then, yeah.
That's one that's asked on this show quite a lot. How do you like your steak?
Medium rare.
Medium rare is the only way to get steak.
Damn, that just happens to be the match. Again, it's some bizarre meme that sort of spilled over into my show, which I've entertained, and you've just said the magic word, and I think I said medium rare as well. So, damn, we think alike. And apparently you two are a Leo as well. So,
yeah.
No wonder I had so much fun at your event. Damn. But anyway, thank you. I think this is time to end the event because, again, we've taken quite enough of your time. And
I hear the Smash music downstairs. They're already here.
Ah, got you, bro. By the way, thank you very much.
No, one more question. Give me one more question. Come on.
Oh damn. This man
What's
is,
your favorite again, animal?
Oh, but
favorite animal, a lion. Why wouldn't it be a lion? What?
Okay,
tigers are not cooler than lions. You kidding me? Tigers will pretend to be your friend, then they'll eat you. A lion, you know never to screw with it. Am I not right? Tigers will be like, come pet me. Lions like, get the fuck off me. Don't ever get close to me, you know? So you at least know. You're not getting trapped. Mm. Go play Smash.
Tigers are sneaky
bastards.
Okay,
hold up. Just at the last minute, since you asked for a last minute question, I have somebody on my Skype, the Mr. of Hubble, please. Well, that's not his name. And he asked about qualifiers, asked about the idea of them.
I mean, to properly do a qualifier, I really think the winner should be compensated to come out to your event. Seeding points do work. Like, I'm actually seeded in Street Fighter 4 at EVO, so in my pool, I don't know, I don't recognize a single name, so I'm excited. So for me, it worked out. A lot of players might not agree. But I mean, qualifiers are good and all. But at the end of the day, people are going to make up their mind if they want to go to an event. If you give somebody an opportunity to win a chance to come to your event, that's always great, too. But I mean, everyone already knows the best tournaments to go to, so they're going to make plans to come to it. And most of the top players that travel to every event, they're already coming to your event anyways. So why give them even, you know, a free trip when they can already afford to go, if that makes any sense? I feel like giving spectators like raffles and stuff a chance to win free trips is the way to go. I feel like at my events, I try to get sticks into the hands of spectators because they would never get a stick otherwise. But the second they get a stick, they go home, play a fighting game with a friend, and they're like, oh my God, this feels like the arcade. They're going to keep coming back. But qualifiers, I mean, it really depends how it goes. I don't think a perfect formula has ever happened. Because there's just so many events, it's just really hard to do that. But I've been considering doing qualifiers with other organizers that want to do something like that. But it really depends on your local community, how bad they want to send out a player or something that otherwise wouldn't have an opportunity to go. So if it's like a scene where there's players you've never heard of, I really think that's the way to do a qualifier. But if it's like a tournament that other top players are already going to and they're just going to win more money to come to your event anyways, I don't think it's worth it.
Okay. I couldn't... Well, actually, can we just get one more in? Because, what was that? Because, that was it. What's yeah? This
that's
is a really-
7 questions, so that's $15 a question. My PayPal is alexjebailey@gmail.com.
A bargain
I'm just kidding. So what's the next one?
A bargain at twice the price. A bargain at twice the price, but where was I? Mr. Adris asked, what is the ratio between players, spectators, and US major? In the case of your CEO, it was almost 50%.
It was about 750 players to 1,000 or so spectators.
So, yeah.
A lot. You have to give them a reason to come, and watch. Before, it wasn't really that many spectators. It was just like the spouses or the close friends of the players coming. But now, CEO, I did radio ads last year, so a lot of people that had no idea what the scene was came out. And I think that's something I've been really doing differently is besides posting on the general forums and Twitter and stuff, I get flyers out to GameStops and local places. So people see that, okay, this is an event. Let me check it out. And then if they have a good time, they're going to come back for life. So you got to reach out other than just online and the usual suspects. You got to really take a chance and try other things.
Okay. But anyway, like I said, this ends the show nicely. I could have not asked for a better show, and I couldn't have asked for... Again, I got the People's Tournament Organizer. Again, I cannot stress this. I can't stress this enough. You helped. You helped Obake in Portugal.
Brilliant.
Whoa! What the hell was that?
What the fuck? Did someone just get bodied?
Hey, I think Skirmish is buying himself.
Skirmish is rage quitting. That's what it is.
We're not playing BCB tonight. You won't be rage quitting later.
Actually, real quick,
later.
Skirmish, you entered a game at CO. Let's go look at your results.
That's not important.
So I started working on all the results, man. I can't read half the brackets, but... I'm already halfway through them. They're on ceogaming.org under results.
That's not very important.
Let's see. General Skirmish, just control. Hey, you did not get last place in Skullgirls. Congratulations.
Oh, wow. Okay. I still went 2-0, but okay. That was
wait, hold on. You came from England and all you entered was Skullgirls?
No, I entered Skullgirls, Injustice, and Dive Kick.
I haven't gone to the full results for those yet. You're probably at the bottom, so.
Aww. Poor Skirmish.
I'm just kidding.
He may have done shit in tournaments, but he's getting all that CPM from all the footage he got.
And dude, he took some great footage, man. I took notice, so make sure you get me that shit.
Oh, yeah, for sure. Again,
my favorite one was his interview with Chris G. At the very end was one of the funniest things I've ever seen. Basically, the camera just knocked over, and the camera was kind of down on the floor, and all of a sudden you see Romance's head poke around in front of the camera with the funniest face ever.
Brilliant.
Oh, it was absolutely brilliant.
I didn't see that yet, but all right, yeah, I do need to get going. It's been an hour and a half.
Yeah.
But, no, thank you, man, for the opportunity to come. Anybody watching, support your local scene, come out and just, have fun. I've told people, I don't have a scene. I'm like, do you have two friends you play with? Yeah, there's your scene. Have fun, have fun with that and just get started and build from it. I mean, arcades are dead. They're long gone. But we have online now. We have internet. Everyone can reach out to each other quicker. Just host casuals. You never know who's going to get involved and build it from there.
Okay, man. But anyway, thank you very much, Mr. Alex Jebailey. And let me just mute my guest and... Again, if you like to follow, and subscribe, again, this was the People's Stream, and you can follow, and I'll put up the VODs onto Article 12, and you can follow me on Twitter. Anyway, guys, the next Tournament Standard Time, some of our heroes from Evo will be coming on our shows. But anyway, adios, guys. On to the people!